halfway through the program and then share a little bit of what's happened since then. So, thanks. My name is Alexander. I was born in the Sioux in 1976. Alcoholism was a problem that started my life before I even took my first drink, as my father struggled with it. Growing up, my father's drinking took its toll on him, my mother, and our family. Their marriage of 20 years deteriorated to the point where my mother finally lost all hope and filed for divorce. Unfortunately, my father did not react well to this news. On May 5th, 1992, my mother's sister and I were out at a restaurant playing darts when my father unexpectedly showed up. I was walking up to the dartboard when I heard my sister scream. I turned to see my father standing at our table holding a gun to my mother's head. In the second that it took me to process what was happening, he pulled the trigger. As the gunshot deafened the room, pandemonium erupted around me, and I stood transfixed as my family life came to an end right in front of me. My mother survived the shooting, but would require 24-hour care for the rest of her life. She was respirator-dependent and paralyzed from the neck down. She would succumb to her injury and passed away a few years later. My father turned himself in and was sent to prison. After being released, he would ultimately end up crawling back inside of a bottle and never came out. He too would die too early in life by drinking himself to death. After the shooting, as bizarre as it seemed, life just simply moved on. I thought I should be feeling something, but I didn't, so I felt I should just choose to move on as well. Though it would take over 20 years for me to realize it, I began to close myself off to the world that day, and this would become an unconscious struggle in my life. I had my first drink when I was 16, and remember to this day the relief it seemed to provide. Instead of seeing the danger in playing with this type of pseudotherapy, alcohol became a dominant driving force in my life. Over the next 11 years, it would consume my mind and take over my thoughts. I went to university, but never finished. I went to college, but never finished. I lost every job I worked. I crossed moral and ethical boundaries I swore I never would. I ruined relationships and friendships. I pawned all of my possessions and then stole from others. I woke up in ditches, hospitals, and jails. I spent months in psych ward and even attempted suicide. My life would be reduced to a 2-week window. Finally, alone one night in a hotel room, the reality of my situation set in. I was no longer living life. I was simply drinking to quit. I realized I would soon end up dead or in jail. The shame that I felt was crushing. It was in that despair that at the age of 27, I turned to God and simply said, "I give up. If you'll show me how, I'll do it your way." In that moment of complete surrender, life changed. I never drank again for the next 10 years.
No one's ever said.
Now, I wish I could tell you that I fought the good fight for the rest of my days and never fell back, but the race is one of endurance and the enemy is patient. Over the course of those next 10 years, I was determined to make up for wasted time. I built a company, built a house, married a beautiful woman, and had 2 beautiful daughters. I was quite active in my church in the early years of my sobriety, but with each hour of my day growing steadily more busy, I pushed God further down my list of priorities until I had no time left over for prayer or the Word. I slowly turned back to living life by my own strength and wisdom, and in that ignorance, I left a foothold for the enemy. Juggling too many facets of a too busy life, the pressure finally cracked through the defenses I had unknowingly constructed to maintain undesirable emotions. After 10 years of sobriety, desperate to regain control of a mind pulling itself apart, I cracked open a bottle to slow down my thoughts. Needless to say, it was a bad plan and it failed. Over the next year, in the messy process of trying to sort out what was happening, I found out that I was experiencing post-traumatic stress disorder because of the shooting. I started to see a therapist, but it was obvious that I needed help that went beyond traditional therapy. This was when the option Teen Challenge was presented. Teen Challenge gave me the opportunity to take an honest look at my relationship with the Lord, to decide once and for all, do I believe in the God I read about in the Bible or not? I could no longer ride the fence, and it was time to decide which side I was going to spend the rest of my life. As I shifted my focus off this temporal world to an eternal kingdom, I've begun to understand both in a way I'm sure I never would have had I not taken the risk of stepping back for a year. If we walk by faith, not by sight, then life's decisions shouldn't be weighed by physical environment alone. In fact, basing my choices on how I perceive the here and now is what ultimately led me away from the Lord in sobriety. Wise choices are made when I accept what Scripture has to say about my circumstances. I'm choosing to seek eternal spiritual truths at the cost of comfort in my temporal surroundings. Proverbs 3, 5 and 6 says to trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. Seek His will, and He will make straight your path. As the months have slowly rolled by at TC, my faith in the Scripture has been continuously challenged. Choosing to stay in the program and trust God instead of going back to work has cost my wife and I our business, our savings, possessions, and now our home. Taking this into consideration, I still confidently believe that I made the wisest choice in my life. So that was, like I said, the testimony I used to read out every weekend when we went out. And that was right around month 7, 8, 9. And then I started freewheeling my testimony. Because in the last couple of months, TC is set up. The first 4 months is putting off the old man. The next 4 months is putting on the new man. The last 4 months is getting ready to go back into society. It took me about 7 months to start putting off the old man, so I was a little slow in the program. 40 years adopting the customs of this world is really frightening and difficult to let go of. I wouldn't say I hated every moment at TC, but it was a very difficult challenge. There is just plain and simply no escape from yourself. And it took me about 6 months just to figure that out. That's where I had the problem. Out here in this world and being back out here again, it is very much aware of me. How easy it is to get distracted, and I don't even mean just by the bad things. I mean, even what seems like a godly plan can get you off track if it's not God's plan. What TC did is, it's a year apart that I wish everybody could experience. I mean, Paul, I don't think there's a man that's lived aside from Christ himself that knew Scripture the way that this man did. And he had to spend 3 years in the desert alone with God. So 1 year was an extremely rare opportunity that a lot of people didn't get. So what I found out, the value of that is you can't escape yourself. They take away all the distractions. Obviously, they stick you out in the back 40 someplace that you can't get a hold of drugs or alcohol, which is what you also find is you have a choice, and you can stay distracted in there if you want to, and guys do. They'll go out and they'll play sports, they'll sit around and have their own yes-men group circles and reconfirm each other. There are guys that dig down and keep taking a look at what the Word has to say about life. And that's what I found out. It's not what my wife has to say, it's not what my friends have to say, it's not what you guys have to say. It's not what the world has to say. It's what God has to say to me. And when you're coming up against the struggles that you've been into, you'll soon find
resolved, and I don't know what they do.
But you can't change them.
I'm with you.
They're out here. They're there. They're everywhere. I mean, they took away a lot of distractions from me. That's great. I was still just as frustrated in there as I was out here. The difference was, though, is that I didn't have all this. I didn't have a TV. I chose not to go just hang out with people all the time. I chose to kind of keep going to the Word. I mean, if I took a year off life with a wife, a mortgage, kids, car payments, everything else, then let's be as responsible as we can about it. And I went in there knowing that I had sobered up once before. I stayed sober for 10 years. You don't get to the kind of life that I was living before I was 27. Without trying to quit many times, because it gets nasty, it gets downright ugly. And I tried many, many times, and when I finally gave my life over, when I was broken, I stayed sober for 10 years after that moment, so I knew going in there that Christ could do it. went in there with a scripture verse in my heart to seek the Lord with all, seek his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you, and all those things, one of them is just sobriety. And I got serious with God, and what I realized is he wants us to always turn over and over to him. And we all say this, and I'm not saying anything against anybody, because I'm just as guilty as everybody else is. You have no idea how many times you sit there and profess one thing, and 10 seconds later and do the exact same thing in violation to what you just professed. My heart had grown callous to so many scriptures, and that's what God did, is kept bringing a lot of the scriptures back up to me and re-examining them in a new way. When you started with a daily relationship with Christ, every morning, out of all the problems TC might have, one thing they've never gotten wrong is every morning you wake up, 365 days that I was in there, 365 half-hour morning sessions I spent in prayer, and I came to know my Maker. I stepped into a relationship, and that's where everything changed, to the point where I realized that's what I did wrong before. God was just conceptual to me. You can't have a relationship with the Almighty Creator of the world and you and be able to just profess one thing and then go out and violate it 5 seconds later. And that's what the relationship part changes. Because in that, the other thing I started to see and acknowledge, and I literally saw him do it. I watched him lead me through scripture to get something into the core of me. Is there's a supernatural working that's going on. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. And again, there's another scripture that I've glazed over so many times, because I got it in my head that, no, this is how I learn the Lord, this is how I do this, or this is not how it feels. It doesn't matter. Get into the Word. Meditate upon the law day and night. Find out what it has to say. It, that book, is how this whole thing came into being. So take a look at it and see what it says about how this machine operates. If you're a mechanic and you walk up to a brand new piece of equipment, you're not just going to start unloosing bolts and putting things around the way that you figure it should be because it looks better this way to you. You have no clue what the ultimate goal of this is. You'll sit down, you'll take a look at a manual, you'll figure out, and then you'll work within the parameters that the designer had set down with that. And that's what I had to learn how to do, and that's why it took 7-8 months. It's because the Lord would bring me over and over and over and show me where I keep taking back control, where I keep choosing, no, this is what I want to study, and this is where I feel on this matter, and this part. And when you actually start to step into it, those who love me will obey me, and those who love me, I will love them, and I will reveal myself to them. Amen. And I watched him do it in scripture, and that's when I started to get the supernatural part that's going on. And then you start coming across scriptures that says that being in the Word, there's a renewing of the mind. Yes, it doesn't matter how you feel. What matters is obeying what the Lord has said, because if you will obey him and trust him, despite how you feel, despite how much it's going to cost you, despite what the world says is ludicrous to do, if you look at that and you start to get it into your heart and get it into your knower that this is where I'm going from this point forward, and I commit my life to this, the rest of it gets a little easier, because you know this is where I'm going back to, and I know there's going to be times my flesh is going to rise up, and I know there's going to be times where I don't understand what it's saying, but I also know that this is what's transformed me up to this point. And then you start walking that experiential faith that leads into a trust. And it was in the last month and a half, that I start to really get these things clicking around. Showing up to church on Sundays, yes, that's great. But if you're just getting fed by your church, forget it. It's never going to happen. Yes, we come here to celebrate the Lord, but there's also fellowship here. It's just holding each other up and everything else. The real nitty-gritty happens between you and the Lord behind closed doors, where he can speak into your heart. I don't mean to be up here and coming across as preachy by any stretch of the imagination. All I'm doing is just sharing my experience, and what it is plain and simply.
It's not what you think it is. It's what the Bible has to say. And if you will start to get into that every day, there is one way that I would talk with other guys and express it about, well, this relationship part. How do you talk to a God that you know isn't talking back to you? I've had the exact same thoughts. I've had the exact same experiences. And one of the things that I used to say to them all the time, you ever been reading through, and all of a sudden the scripture just jumps out and grabs, oh yeah, yeah, they identify that right off the bat. That's God talking to you right there. That's the Holy Spirit. That's the supernatural work. You're experiencing it. Stop. In North America, we've got it into our heads. We've got to get all the information in there. We've got to be able to, we look at it as, and that's how I came up with a conceptual God, is because I looked at the Bible as a textbook. Didn't say it, but that's what I was doing. And I'm trying to get that information in, and I had not acknowledged, I glazed over the scriptures that said it's a supernatural working, mm-hmm. that you hear, mm-hmm. or that your faith comes by hearing, and by hearing the word of God. Mm-hmm. That's why Christ himself, I was listening to Francis Chan a little while ago, and I just find this priceless, the way that he puts it. He talks about the parable of the sower, mm-hmm. and he says that Jesus comes out, I mean, there's thousands of people that have come out to see him. He walks up, and his sermon is basically, there's this farmer, he sowed some seeds on the ground, some fell on hard ground, and you know, they were burnt up, and they didn't root, others fell on shallow ground, and the sun burnt out, they didn't get enough nutrition, so they burnt out, other ones grew up amongst the thorns, and they got choked out, and then some fell on the good ground, and they brought forth, you know, 100-fold, and if you get it, you get it, you don't, and walked away, kind of idea. And that's the thing is, what is he saying in that? Why is he being like that? Because he's not looking. He doesn't want the crowds. He wants the people who are truly seeking after him. Amen. That are going to sit there in that frustration and go, well, that seems silly, but okay, well, let's dig into it deeper. Let's take a look at what he's actually trying to say. And that's what his disciples did. They followed right after him. And he follows it up by saying, you guys get it. You guys are coming after me and looking for it. You can't do this once a week. It's got to be every day.
Every day.
And I mean, don't beat yourself up if you miss it, but I'm trying to say, and again, I'm not trying to tell you how to live it. I'm just trying to tell you the experience that I came through came because every day I got into that word, and every day, even on the days where it was dry, still chose to get into it, because 3 days later, 3 weeks later, he would pour something into me, and all of a sudden, I remember reading that and go back into it, and all of a sudden, there's a whole river stream of life sitting there that explains some things. The other reason why, as far as getting into it every day, is because, especially out there, again, no distractions, so I choose to keep going back to the word, and you start to get God's MO. You start to catch the flow of his rhythm. And there was, early in the program, I was going through something, and I was getting to a point where I was frustrated, and I can't tell you exactly what these moments were, but I felt like, what am I missing here? What am I not getting? But I chose to keep on going through the word, and I was getting more and more frustrated, and then all of a sudden something would happen, and a breakthrough, and I'd get it in the scripture, or somebody would confirm something, or somebody would explain something, or I'd get a phone call, or however, well, I didn't get a phone call, I would make a phone call, I'm not allowed to get phone calls, but, and then I would come out on the other side and look back in hindsight, and I would see it, and I would catch on to it. It's like, okay, no, that's what God was, that's what happened, blah, 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 and then you know, I've got to remember this. And then 3 weeks later, I'd be in the middle of something else. Same idea, different story. And I would come out on the other side of that one and go, oh yeah, that's right. I've got to remember this for the next time kind of thing. And the third time, and it was on the third time, I was halfway into it, and I was feeling frustrated. And it was like, where are you on this, God? What am I messing up? What am I not? Wait a second, I remember doing this already. Feeling the exact same things, thinking the exact same things. I'm okay. You are right here with me. And work instead of being frustrated, instead of wasting my time looking at everything all up walking by sight, let's start walking by faith, and you tell me that you're there with me, and I've already seen your MO happen in my life. I have an experiential faith now, and then I start to step into a trust, and the trust said, it's all good. We're working all things towards good because I've called you according to my purpose, and you obey me, and you love me. Amen. And it changed everything. Now, instead of trying to go around a problem, alleviate a problem, fix a problem, all I'm doing is looking for God in it. and you cannot adopt his customs and his ways if all you're doing is looking at the environment around you.
That's right.
Because you're going to look back to your flesh.
Mm-hmm.
The trust thing, like I said, it was in the last month, and it broke me. Because where he got me was, he got me in relationship to my wife. And I'll be a little open and candid here, but what it was is my wife didn't want me to go back into business when I came back home. We had lost everything, and in the process, I mean, it happened within the first 4 months that the business was shut down. And so in that time, I mean, I ran that business for 11 years up to that point. So with all the numbers that float around in my head, I re-ran the numbers, what it would look like for myself and just one or two employees. And I put it all down on paper, quickly realized I'd never thought about downsizing. I was always growing. So when I look at the numbers downsizing, I'm like, this is ridiculous. Why didn't I do this before? I'm only going to lose 10, 15% net profit. I'm like, and it's a no-brainer. The stress levels go down. And so, but I just analyzed it, and then I put it away because I was busy putting off the old man. It wasn't until the last 4 months that I started to think about coming back out and think about the business. And my wife started to make it pretty plain that she didn't want me going back there. And I felt that she saw the business as what turned me and spun me off. And okay, yeah, I grant you that had its stresses, but there was a lot of other things that were work. And it wasn't even just the shooting either. The number one thing is that I was not living my life according to the way the designer said that this machine runs. And so every time I would present it back to her, I get it. To myself, I had it in my head that she sees the business as the problem. And so I'd explain it to her. It's like, I don't have 6, 7 employees. I don't have 6, 7 other social lives that I've got to figure out for people. I don't have, the two employees that I have will be with me every day. I'm talking to them every day. I won't have 3 different builders. I won't have all these commercial contracts. I won't have these cold calls coming in for repaints because I'm not doing any of that. Sticking with one builder, he's not even going to call me because I'm on his job site every day. And it's just, I'm going into an area where I'm comfortable, where I know I'm strong, where I know I can do all this stuff. And you want me to go off and potentially take another job someplace else, and I have to learn their new systems. And so that actually caused me more stress. And then God got a hold of me and said, reminded me of a whole bunch of scriptures I got at the beginning of the program. And one of them was, is how are you supposed to love your wife? Well, I'm supposed to love my wife as you love the church. And yeah, and how did I love the church? Well, you loved it to the point that you died for it. And he was like, yeah. Wife's not asking you to throw yourself on the train tracks. She doesn't want you to go back to business. And then the flesh rises up. Yeah, but. Yeah, but. Yeah, but. Yeah, but. I know I can do this. I know that I can make the money. I know that, and it's not that I want to make the money and redeem and everything else. And then you just start going on this wishy-washy trail that just gets nowhere instead of just acknowledging that's what you said to do. How about I just do it and get to that point where you want to bring me a whole lot faster? But that's not how yet. And so we went back and forth on that a little bit, and I sulked about it for a little while, wouldn't admit to you that that's what I was doing, but then I finally kind of came to the realization, it's like, okay, I'm going to choose to obey you on this. I don't get it. It makes more sense. And then kind of showed it to me. It's like, yeah, but I told you to love your bride as you love yourself. You're giving your wife all these reasons about why it makes you comfortable, and she's still standing there telling you why she's uncomfortable, and you're trying to reason away what she's saying for yourself. Now, I'm not arguing whether we're right or we're wrong in that. What I am saying is that I wasn't listening to what God has put down in His Word, and I was choosing to put myself first before my wife. And so once I decided, okay, fine, I'm not going back to business, plain and simple. I don't know where it goes from there, but I've seen enough of your ebb and flow to realize this is how it works. So we're going to do that. After I stepped into that and made the commitment, again, if you're just going to kind of gingerly feel it out, well, I'll go home, and if it's not going so well, then I'm going to go back to business. No, not going back to business. And I shut the door on that idea. And I don't know where we're going from there, but basically what I said to him is, that's your responsibility. That ain't mine at this point. So I left it alone, and then about a week later, then he brought me back into this whole equation one more time. And I started to get it a little more clearly because of that, about putting my wife before, and I'd been praying into that and been thinking about a few things. And I got to a point where the flesh got more exposed. We pulled off the callus, and I saw where some more of the raw meat is at, and I started to realize, yeah, but I know my wife, and I know that she thinks this way, and I know she does that, and I know she can do this and everything else. And basically, I'm not going to make any bones about it, as I saw how my wife was going to take advantage of me laying down my life for her. And that's when things really changed, because that's when I saw trust in a completely different manner. And what he showed me is like, that's not your responsibility, and you aren't the fortune teller of that. What have I asked you to do? I asked you to lay down your life, and I asked you to trust me that I'm going to take care of it. Trust me that I'm going to take care of your wife, first off, and trust me that I've made your wife the way that she is, and her struggles are ordained in such a way that it's working both for her good and your good, because that's how big of a God I am. And I will pull this all around. You don't worry about that part of it. You just step into it. And that is scary. That's the thing. This is when, and that's when I started to see. Sorry if you feel judged. That's not what I'm trying to do. But that's where I see we all did this, because that's where I saw myself. Is we are willing to go so far. And God will pull back a layer, and it's like, okay, and you struggle through that, and you come up, oh, that's awesome, and you see what God did and everything else. But then he's going to want to take you a step deeper. You don't get to 40 years old adopting the customs of the world and think that, okay, I made a simple choice, and now, okay, we're ready to rock and roll with God wherever he wants to lead. It doesn't work that way, because 10 minutes later, you're going to forget what he had already spoken to you when somebody else comes up to you and kisses you off. And so that's what changed everything. It was seen, and it was just so cool that that's how God does it. He does it with my life partner, with the other half of me, is how he demonstrates it for me. This is what trust is. Trust is spirit-led life. That's what I was trying to figure out at the beginning when I went into that program, is what a spirit-filled, spirit-led life looks like. And if you're going to be led by the Spirit, get ready to be uncomfortable for the rest of your life. Like, it seems that generations have shifted and changed to a certain extent that everybody kind of recognizes that the 80s was the prosperity gospel, whether it was finances or whether it was good feelings, good times kind of thing. And everybody's starting to acknowledge that, no, there's more to it, that he is going to lead you into suffering. Yeah, that's the first scripture that I saw the Holy Spirit working on me. We are joint heirs with Christ. As we share in his glory, so too shall we share in his suffering.
Yeah.
And don't think that just because, oh, it's suffering, okay, yeah, it's going to suffer. No, man, he's going to hit you right at home. He's not going to hit you just with the persecution and people coming up against you. He's going to hit you where you're the biggest hindrance to your walk. It ain't anybody else. Don't hit yourself. And yeah. For me, I deluded and kidded myself many times over, and I bargained with a whole bunch of things, to the point where I did not even see that I had absolutely no trust. Because yes, to trust him with one thing is one thing, but God wants to permeate all aspects, all facets, and your entire core of who you are. Why? So that he can be reflected in you. If you can get the heck out of the way and let God call the shots for you, you step in. Now we're operating out of our weakness and his strength. And that's what changes lives around you. That's part of the reason why it took me so long to come to Christianity, is because up to that point, I had never seen another spirit-filled, spirit-led life. I had not seen this beacon that moths are drawn to. I had seen good church-going folks. But I did not see, in North America, it's rare to see it because of the distractions. And I'm not bashing anybody. I know you're all good people. I'm just saying what I saw in myself is the fact that I couldn't even get over myself yet. So how was I supposed to expect God to really work in my life when I was even oblivious to how much I was shutting him out? After being out here for going on 3 weeks, no, 2 weeks, just finished up being out here for 2 weeks, it was the first few days borderline terrifying because I could see all the distractions. And I knew, okay, I've just got to find the pace in this place and everything else. I'm also not living in my own home. Like, everything. God started us clean slate day one. We're living with Chris and Allison, so I don't have my own home base kind of thing. And he's kept me uncomfortable. And I don't like it. I really don't like it in the flesh. But when I get out of my own head, I get out of my own way, and I look to the Spirit, one of the things I realized around month six in TC, every time I get agitated, upset, angry, nervous, whatever the case is, feelings I don't want to have, it's because I'm focusing in the flesh. I'm focusing on my life. I'm focusing on the surroundings around me. And that led me into the question, well, how do I get out of that? And that's when, for the first time, that's what a Spirit-filled, Spirit-led looks like, life looks like. It's because I go to the Scriptures and see what God says about this circumstance. I go into prayer and I pray into it. And I look for God in the midst of those problems. And when I do that now, and there's plenty of distractions here and now, when I do that, I see how he's got complete control of this. I am walking in the right direction. Why? Because I'm uncomfortable. He's keeping me on edge to keep me looking back to him. Now, sooner or later, we're either going to have a bit of a breakthrough in that, or I'm going to go back to the world. I'm going to go back to my own strengths. And this is where the Sundays come in. This is where the unity in the church helps us each other. There's one another watching each other. This is what your Sunday is about. Yes, we come to talk about the Father, but it's about a unity of asking each other how things are going in our lives. Let's get real with what's going on in our lives. And most of the time, we don't have the time because, oh, it's 11:30 and, you know, I got a lawn to mow or something. I mean, and this is, after church, that was me. I always wanted out. And so it's still very uncomfortable for me to stick around after church because in the flesh, that's not me. I don't like that. But I also understand something about unity, and I learned it through this church because when I was gone for that year, you guys stepped up like a church that I read about in the Bible.
Amen.
It wasn't just about, a lot of you know the circumstances that were happening and everything else. And I appreciate those who, you know, wanted to help us out with money and everything else. I'm not taking anything away from that, but the people that gave up their time, thank you. Because that's what showing unity is. It's actually being actively involved in other people's lives so that we can learn to grow together as a family.
Amen.
And we can learn to trust each other, that we're actually there. Yeah, there's times where I'd appreciate that check for $15,000 that solves a lot of problems in it. But it doesn't draw you and I closer with him. Unless God's speaking that into him, by all means. You got checks for $15,000. But I never really saw that in a church before. And I didn't even see it when it was happening here. I saw it through the eyes of the Spirit. As the Spirit taught me what unity was all about.
Mm-hmm.
Month two into the program, I've really taken up a lot of time. Month two into the program, I went in there needing to know how to be a better father and a better husband. And I started to see a lot of that. It was the first time in my life in 12 years up to that point. 2 weeks had gone by. In 12 years, I had streamlined the company before I left as best I could, and I knew I had to give it up. So when I went there, I got into the work right off the bat, and I chose not to even think about business because I would spin myself out doing that. 2 weeks went by, and I realized it was the first time in 12 years that I had not thought about my company for that period of time. And that blew my mind away. I'm like, that's really where my life has been. I have not, even on vacation, I've had a week and a half vacation, and I've never made it that long. So what am I thinking about? And I realized all I'm thinking about is my family and God. I'm like, okay, well then I'm on the right track. And so then I kept on pushing further into a few things. And I started to understand a few things. God brought up that scripture about loving my wife as I love myself and it hit me in a different way. And it's like, you're not kidding around. That's not a metaphor. You're literally saying that. Mm-hmm. And so I was working through all that and I was starting to come to a couple realizations of a few things. And this is only a month into the program. And then I was walking down for lunch one day and I'm walking down the ramp and all of a sudden God just hit me with it. It was basically, because I was thinking on these things, I was thinking about, okay, oh, that's what I'm going to do. That's what I'm committing myself to. And then all of a sudden, God brought it to me. It's like, number one commandment, Jesus, I'd read this just a week before. Jesus had summed up the law in basically two commandments. Number one, love the Lord with all your soul and with all your spirit. And number two, love your neighbor as yourself. And it literally stopped me dead in my tracks. It's like, yes, I know you're getting it now about your wife and your kids, but I want you to love everybody like that. And it stopped me dead in my tracks because, like, are you kidding me? I don't even like talking to people on the phone, man. You want me. Month one, this is how you're going to hit me with it. And the reason why he hit me with that is because it would be several months later, and I can't point you to a direct scripture. I can just point you to the fact that I started to catch the character of Christ through understanding his word and reading through his word and understanding how vitally important unity is. It's all it is. It's unity with him first and us second. And I'd read that in, but still didn't get it. That's the whole point of all this game. The rest of this is all going to burn. It's got no value. The only thing you will carry forward is the relationships that you forged down here. So when you're so convinced that you got to leave because you got to take care of that lawn and everything else, and I'm go mow your lawn. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying check yourself every now and then. Get into the Word, and when God brings something into your heart, stop. Quit focusing on, I got to get my 2,200 words in here because that's what I do every day because that's how God's happy with me and everything else. When God's speaking to you in that scripture, stop. And if it takes you the next month to get through that scripture, that's exactly where you're supposed to be so that God can take you further. Because if you will not get into that scripture, especially if it's taking you that long, then the rest of it, I'm not saying it's a waste. I don't understand how he works. But I do know you are short sheeting yourself on that one. So, again, I just wanted to thank everybody that wanted to thank the church as a whole for actually showing me what unity in a church is about. Because I kid you not, I had never seen it before. And I thank you for everybody that did step up and did help us out. I'm sure there's people that I don't even know about. That helped us out in many ways. And thank you for helping my wife along. And I pray and hope that you all realize I still need you just as much as I did before.
Amen.
Because I'm just starting to get some spiritual truths figured out. And really, we always talk about moving off from the pablum and moving on to the meat and potatoes. I never ever got on to the meat and potatoes because I never ever figured out how to digest the pablum in the first place. So, thank you guys very much. Thanks for letting me spiel.